Shalom everybody, I'm Hadar Plant and welcome to Faithful Cooking. Welcome to a mini Bible study. This time we're going to start talking about God's actual laws. We've already mentioned that He gave us the strength to endure temptation in 1 Corinthians 10:13 and the strength to resist temptations to sin. And we already know that He's expecting us to follow His word. And that's why He died for us, to rescue us from the power of sin. So now we're going to find out what His word actually is. And before I start, I would love to address your question because that's really important.
Okay.
There's no way that I have ordained a high priest to do animal sacrifices. And this is the reason why. Right now there is no temple. The way God commanded to do animal sacrifices is in the temple specifically, nowhere else. There is a very tiny group, very tiny group of religious, not even leaders, maybe just people, that want to rebuild the temple. Now, this is what's going on. Where the temple is supposed to stand right now, there's a Dome of the Rock that's in Muslim mosque. Now, Israel is trying to have peace in the Middle East. And it's not working because most other Arab countries in the Middle East just want to annihilate Israel. They don't want peace, real peace. Mm-hmm. So there's war all the time and terrorism attacks all the time.
אוהד חמה חוזרים אליך, שם...
זה אתה יודע, דני, לפני כמה דקות הייתה הזקה, אבל דין טיל על תל אביב כדין טיל על סדרות או על אשדוד, ודמם של תל אביבים וירושלמים לא אדום יותר מזה של תושבי סדרות אשדוד ובכלל תושבי הדרום.
אבל את יודעת שזה משפט שפוליטיקאים מאוד אוהבים להשתמש בו, אבל הוא לא תקף.
אני אומרת אותו בפעם הראשונה בחיי.
בגלל שיש כל הזמן, בסדר, סליחה שאני עושה אחרות, הוא לא תקף כי אנחנו יודעים שיש כל הזמן, גם בימי שגרה, שיגורים, טפטופים, המילה הנוראית הזאת של פצמרים וכדומה.
זה נכון, אני
אחרי איזה פיצוץ.
סמק, עוד אחד. אחי, יש בטוח פצועים, אני אומר לך.
מה?
תראה מה זה.
זה דירור?
וואי! שיוו!
בתוך הבסיס! בתוך הבסיס!
הסרטון הזה שמופץ ברשתות החברתיות מתאר את חייהם של ילדי גן גורים. רק בני שנתיים וחצי וכבר מתורגלים במציאות של אזעקות ומרחבים מוגנים.
סיפרנו להם שאם פעם יזרקו כדורים ואנחנו נשמע איזשהו צליל...
כל הקהל ייכנס עכשיו לתוך האולם למרחב מוגן, חבר'ה, יש לנו מעל הרוב, להיכנס לאולם, כולם!
In order to maintain a certain level of peace, the Dome of the Rock is considered under, supposedly, like it belongs to either Jordan or Palestine, I don't remember which one. But basically that means that there is, it's a no-fly zone at all, for no one, or about that, not for Israel, not for any other forces at all. Muslims are the only ones that are actually allowed to pray there. Anyone else can go up there and look around as a tourist. You're not allowed to pray up there, and Jews are not allowed to pray up there either, at all. Okay, they literally get arrested by the Israeli military. That's how Israel's trying so hard to keep the peace. Lord, please be with those people in this disaster, Lord. And be with them, Lord, and give them your strength to endure this, Lord. And bring them a miracle, Lord. Show them your truth and your salvation and your love and your power. And just be with them, Lord, in Yeshua's most precious name. Amen. So, what's happening is that a very, very small group of people, they once in a while go up there, supposedly as tourists, and they like literally start laying stones, and they get arrested. Or they want to pray, and they get arrested. So Israel is actually preventing the rebuilding of the second temple. That means that there is no way they are ordaining a priest or high priest. The most that Israel has is just a rabbi. And that basically means someone, because Israel is a democratic Jewish state, it's someone that is guiding and what that means to have a Jewish state. So there is a freedom of religion there for everyone. There are Muslim citizens as well, there is all that. But there is also specific Jewish freedoms like sabbatical days. That means days that you do not work. Those are all Jewish holidays, and Shabbat, which is Saturday, like we discussed last month. And that would be times that everyone would be off work unless you work in a 24/7 place. So you are allowed to employ people, let's say if you're a hotel or a 24/7 restaurant or a grocery store, but you will have to pay them 200%, and they don't have to work on that day. So there are some rights that people have that they don't really have here at all, as far as I've seen so far. So there are things like that, but as far as the temple is concerned, I don't see it happening in our lifetime the way it's going on right now, because there has to be a temple. And the point, I believe also maybe why God allowed it to be destroyed in the first place, is that Once Yeshua died for us, he became sacrifice once and for all. So the Lord said, enough with the other sacrifices, because there's one once and for all. So we're not supposed to make any sacrifices anymore. Also, I actually read an extreme religious article about the name of God pronunciation. Because the name of God is Yud Hei Vav Hei. It's four letters in Hebrew. Everyone knows how to spell it. It's a combination of the words Hayah Ve'Yeh, which means was, is, and will be. Now, his name, no one knows truly how to pronounce it. Now, there are some Hebrew Bibles that have, in Hebrew you have dots under the letters. There's no actual vowel letters that tell you how to read things. Some Bibles don't have dots under the letters at all, which don't tell you how to read his name. Some Bibles do have it, and usually when they have it, they would spell it Yehovah. Mm-hmm. It would spell it Yehovah. Now, the other names that modern Christianity is familiar with, apparently, based on what I read, the Catholic Church came up with Yehovah, which I don't know where the devil came from, to be honest. And then later on, Protestants came up with Yahweh. And they supposedly studied it from Hebrew names, except that if you really look into those Hebrew names with God's name in it, the same letters are pronounced differently in different names. It's just his letters that are in their names, not necessarily the pronunciation. The reason, based on what I read, and that's the beautiful part, that no one knows truly how to pronounce his name is because right before the destruction of the Second Temple, which is pretty much right where when Yeshua died for us, and it actually, that website of non-believer Jewish religion leaders acknowledges that it was around the same time Yeshua walked the earth, even mentions him. The priests in the temple, they were serving God, they were present in the presence of God regularly. Because in the Holy of Holies, the high priest would literally visit God. That was his throne. They say that around that time, they couldn't feel God's presence anymore. They didn't get any revelations from him anymore. The Holy Spirit left. Why did that happen? We know. We know that it's because now the Holy Spirit lives within us, within the believers, those who truly follow God and are called according to his purpose and belong to Yeshua, to the Messiah. They weren't, so he left. They didn't know why. The high priest at that time, who was according to that website a righteous man, died, didn't choose a successor in priest because he couldn't get a revelation from God who that next priest is supposed to be. So he didn't reveal how to truly pronounce the name of God to anyone else after him. It's today no one else. That's why. That's really interesting and beautiful. So there may be that small group of people that's either spreading that rumor or that's trying to get some kind of support from people to try and rebuild the temple because they want to do that because they don't know Yeshua came and they think they're still supposed to do sacrifices. Israel is definitely trying to stop them, so there's no way it's happening anytime soon at all.
On the news, they said that they've come up with it. They've got some type of.
I'm going to link two videos. Yeah. Two videos around now. That one is Fox News, I think it was, talking about a UFO above the Temple Rock in Jerusalem in 2011. Yeah, I was there at that time. I don't even remember. It didn't make big news in Israel at all because it was false. It was hoax.
Oh, wow.
In Israel, they don't care about hoaxes. But here, in the Fox News, the actual Fox News lady was saying, is he coming? What is that? And they were like, oh, UFO, and that's it. It's like, seriously, people, check your facts before you put it on the news. Because in Israel, they check their facts before they put it on the news. If something's on the news, it's true. And if it's not the very next day, they're going to announce it on the news. Now, I'm going to link the second video I'm going to link is a guy, an American guy actually, that actually bothered looking into it a little bit online and found out why it happened and how. Apparently, there was some kind of generators that were put in there by the Jordanian government, I think. I don't remember who the people that actually have, you know,
in the mosque.
Under the mosque, control over the mosque, and the reason is because to my understanding, they're trying to build an underground mosque under the mosque. I'm not really sure. There's tunnels there that they're excavating there. I'm not really sure what's going on. I've never been inside. You have to go to the men's side to go inside, so you have to be men to do that. The Western Wall is split to men and women's side.
Oh.
Which is the supporting wall of the actual mountain that they built the temple on. But, so those generators were there, and then, here comes a light show, and no flight zone, nothing on the radars, nothing going on. Everybody freaked out, put it on YouTube, filmed from four different angles at least, simultaneously. The thing was going on for a few seconds.
People get caught up into frenzies all the time, right?
Well, she didn't actually say the name Jesus on TV, but she said, is he coming back? Or is he back?
Oh.
Yeah, and it's like, American culture,
you know, this little blob orb thing that like came down and it just hung out and then it shot up in the sky and sat there for a while and then came down again as Jesus? So he's going to come as he left in the clouds and everybody's going to know.
Lord.
It's not going to be
this tiny little thing. He's not going to hover there and say, oh, my place isn't there anymore, and I'm always scared.
It's going to be a very, very public affair.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, this is one problem I have with all the many, many, many end time videos we've seen on YouTube. You know, they're claiming that the mark of the beast, what the mark of the beast is or who the beast is, but then they're forgetting this one really big thing that Revelation is also saying among the rest of the prophecies. The beast will stand in the temple of God and claim to be God. The temple of God has to be the real temple. Not a copy somewhere else in the world. The real temple in the real place where God said it would be. That is the only thing that will refer to the temple of God. There is no temple of God yet. That means there is no beast yet. That means there is no mark of the beast yet. Whether if it will come from what those videos are saying it would, I don't know. But, you know, it's only God knows.
Also, our body is like the temple for the Holy Spirit, but that's not the temple of God.
Yes, our body is referred to the temple of the Holy Spirit, and that's because the Holy Spirit of God lives in us, and you can say the temple of God because God is one, we only have one God, and the Holy Spirit
is
God.
Yes, but we are many members.
Holy Spirit is God.
I know, but what I'm saying is, like, how can His temple and my temple and your temple, how can one thing stand in that and claim to be God?
Because the one thing is... Okay.
I'm talking about the abomination.
The abomination can stand in our bodies and claim to be God.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Okay. I'm just trying to dispel that.
Definitely. So it's definitely not going to be our bodies, obviously. It's going to be the actual temple, physical temple of God. There will be a third temple. Now, we as believers are not supposed to try and rebuild it because we are very clearly commanded by Yeshua to not try and bring the day of the Lord. We're actually supposed to pray to delay the day of the Lord because the day of the Lord will be a terrible day. We're not supposed to pray for it. So what we're supposed to be focusing on is shining light to the world.
Yeah.
Not actually causing events to happen. Because if God prophesied them, they'll happen whether we want it or not. So we really should not be fighting for it. basically, if you actually see a temple really being built in Israel, like in reality, not in rumors, definitely run for the hills, because that means something's coming. But I gotta be honest with you, I don't see it happening in our lifetime, and I don't see it happening in our children's lifetime, the way things are going on right now in Israel.
Okay.
There's no way. It's way too much tension on the Temple Mount. There's way too much going on. ISIS has nothing to do with the Temple Mount, right?
Wouldn't Islam have something to do with the Muslim Sabbath?
Well, there's a lot of different streams of Islam. I'm not really an expert, but ISIS is relatively new, and the mosque has been there since before I was born, probably. Mm-hmm. I mean, if I understand correctly by the news, ISIS is killing other Muslims that just don't look the same way they do, so there's got to be some differences.
Yeah,
So all I know is that the land of Israel, in order to have peace, has literally given that mosque, the Temple Mount, to the Muslims. And the Israeli military and police are defending them there.
Wow.
And enforcing the rule that because this place is holy to them, no one other than Muslims are allowed to pray there. Not Jews, not Christians, no one. Only Muslims are allowed to pray there. And if a Jew goes up there and tries to pray, he's getting arrested. So, yeah, that's the truth of what's really going on. And, all right, so, we're going to be today starting our introduction to the Word of God. Okay? We know we need to obey the Word. We've made that very clear. God has made that very clear. But let's see what His Word actually says. I'm not going to dive in straight to the 613 commandments because that's a lot. So we're going to slowly go through them over the Bible studies, which we have more often than just once a month, but we'll do that. We are, however, going to start with the Ten Commandments. And usually I compare the text that I read from the CJB or Messianic Translation Bible, Messianic World Bible, which I've also found to be pretty good, to the Hebrew in order to make sure it's authentic when I bring it forth. Unfortunately, neither of them is close enough and accurate enough, so I'm going to free translate from the Hebrew. Bear with me, okay? I'm going to do my best to be as accurate as possible. If something is not clear, ask me. I will try to be, you know, more specifically accurate, because the problem with it is usually grammar. Okay, so we are reading from, well, I am reading, I don't know if I can do it in Hebrew, sorry, from Shmot, names in Exodus in English. Don't know why. From chapter 20, okay, that's where the Ten Commandments are spoken. And God spoke all these things to say, I am Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, your God, that have let you out from the land of Egypt, from the house of slaves. You will not have another God before me. You will not make yourself a statue in every image that is in heaven above, and in the earth beneath, and in the water under the earth. You will not bow down to them. You will not serve them. Because I am Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, your God, am a jealous God, commander of the iniquities of the fathers upon the sons, upon the third and fourth to my haters, and as grace to the thousands to those who love me and keep my commandments. You will not carry the name of Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, your God, in vain. Because Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh will not cleanse the one that will carry his name in vain. Remember the Shabbat day to keep it holy. 6 days you will work and did all your chores. And on the seventh day is Shabbat to Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, your God. Shabbat means strike also. You will not do any work, you and your sons and your daughters and your slave and your servant and your beast and the Gentiles that are in your gates. Because 6 days Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh has made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. And he has rested on the seventh day. Therefore Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh blessed the seventh day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days will be long upon the earth that Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, your God, has given to you. You will not murder. You will not commit. Well, the word here is sexual immorality. That pretty much means, yeah, whether if it's in marriage, outside of marriage. Professor, yeah, Pastor told me once that there's a difference in English between adultery and fornication, but in Hebrew it's the same word. That's pretty much what I mean. So, you will not steal, you will not answer to your friend false testimony. You will not covet the house of your friend, you will not covet the wife of your friend, and his slave, and his servant, and his bull, and his ox, and everything that is to your friend. And all the people that see the voices and the torches and the voice of the shofar is the other thing, and the mountain of smoke, and will fear the people, and they moved and stood far away, and they said to Moshe, Moshe is Moses in English, Speak to us, you, and we will hear. And don't let God speak to us or we'll die. And Moshe said to the people, do not fear, because in order to try you, test you, came God. And in order for his fear to be on your faces, so that you will not sin. And the people stood afar, and Moshe came into the midst, like a fog, where God was. And Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh said to Moshe, thus say to the people of Israel, you have seen that from the heavens I have spoken to you. You will not make with me a god of silver and a god of gold. You will not make for yourself. An altar of dirt you will make for me. And you have sacrificed upon it your sacrifices and your peace offerings, your sheep and your cattle. Anywhere that I will mention my name, I will come to you and bless you. And if an altar of stones you will make for me, do not build it from cut stones, because your tool, you've put on it, your sword actually, you've put on it and you have defiled it. And, you know, do not put on my, do not go up to my altar so that your nakedness will not be revealed upon it. That's something that was explained to me by a religious guy that because when they built the tabernacle's replica in a lot, it was very clear that there was a ramp to the altar so they could go up and actually put the sacrifices on it because it was really tall, but no steps because that's what God told you to do. And that religious guy explained that the reason is because they weren't allowed to go up the steps, they had to go up a ramp to be more modest. And this is the first time I've seen something similar in the Bible. Don't go up to the altar. So don't go up a step.
Now here,
that's why there's a ramp, I guess.
And King James says, neither shall you go up by steps unto my altar, that your nakedness be not discovered on that.
You see, that's the thing. They, in a lot of translations, they have, I'm not sure what the correct word in English is, but kind of explained their own understanding of the word. And that's usually what we do when we translate. It's really difficult sometimes to be accurate to the source, but then you miss things.
Sure.
For example, what hit me real hard today when I read it earlier is verse 7. It says, it's very commonly recognized as don't, you know, speak or take the name of God in vain. I've seen in the movie, someone said Jesus Christ, and another, it was two police officers, and the other one told him, don't take the name of my Lord in vain. And that's how people understand that verse means. But if I read it in the Hebrew, that word means carry. Carry as in you carry a bag. Carry as in speaking is also the carry, a form of it. And that's something that hits me hard, because if we claim to carry God's name, whether if it's with a symbolic necklace or his actual name anywhere, or if we just proclaim that we are believers, whether if it's a church or a congregation or anything, but we don't truly live for him and shine his light instead of our own, then we are a false advertisement. We are a false representation of his name, but we claim to carry his name, but we carry it in vain instead of for him. And that's the understanding, the revelation that I got from that.
Yeah.
And I think that's really powerful. Before I continue, it's important to me to know if there's any questions, because I know that people sometimes have a hard time understanding the translation from the Hebrew very well in English.
My biggest issue with the free translation is that sometimes it comes out in a funny tense.
Yeah.
Like she says that you have sacrificed on it, but you know that you will sacrifice because it's not in existence yet. He's saying that you're going to build it and you're going to do it like this.
That's how the biblical language is.
Yeah.
Everything is past tense, even though it hasn't, it's future tense. It's weird, I know, but that's how it's written. I'm trying to be as true to text as I can. And that being said, grammar between Hebrew and English is extremely different, so it makes it quite difficult. Some people, they're like, come on, come on, what's the problem? Wait, hang on. I need to understand what I'm reading, I need to translate it. It's biblical Hebrew, which is different too. You gotta, you don't know the other language, you have no idea what that means. So it's really funny to me when people go and like, come on, come on, what the problem is. All right, so we see the God, he didn't say here, I'll put the link to the verse because I don't remember where it is. He says, God is telling us very clearly that he is one God. He's saying, I'm one God. And here, he's identifying himself, saying, I am Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, or however he pronounced his name, because it makes it very clear that he is the one speaking. In verse 15, the people are terrified because they heard God speaking. Verse 15 and 16. It may be different in the English too. I have 23 verses here total. You have 26. Yeah. That's another problem I have with, I don't know why English translations decided to change verses. Yeah,
some of these in the last chapters.
Sometimes they split verses into two and like, or shrink two verses into one, or just make a verse zero. Like it's not only a headline, it's not even a verse. And then verse one starts at verse two. It's a big mess, especially in Psalms and first five books and pretty much most of the Old Testament. So, yeah, it says very clearly that the people heard God speaking.
Wow.
Now, and they became afraid. They became terrified. Because
they don't die for his voice anymore.
But Moshe is actually telling them that God has came so that his fear will be on your face and you will not sin. You see, it is good for us and it is wisdom. And I'm sure, I don't remember where the verse is, Proverbs maybe? I'll put it out. You're going to have to watch it on YouTube later. I'm sorry to get the addresses. It says that it's wisdom to have a fear of God.
Mm-hmm.
He did not give us a spirit of fear, that's true, from the world, from the enemy, from our situations, whether it's financial or any other kind.
Mm-hmm.
But it is healthy and wise for us to fear God because he is our Father and he does love us, that's true.
Mm-hmm.
And we do have a personal relationship with him. He's also our King.
Mm-hmm.
And he's also to be honored and respected. And most importantly, he's also our God.
What did Ken say in the sermon today? God told you to do it, just do it.
What Ken said in the sermon today, Luke 19, 1 through 10, I believe that's like a perfect example of repentance. And read it in the CJB. We saw that.
CJB.
CJB. Messianic is too close to King James. It's kind of. Some places it's really like, I found two verses, like singular verses, that the Messianic Bible so far was better than the CJB as far as comparing it to the Hebrew with accuracy. But most of other stuff, the CJB did seem to be better, but like I said, today, neither of them was that good because both of them were completely explaining the chapter I just read according to their own understanding. And you pretty much don't even have the revelation of verse 7 there anymore. And I said, okay, we want the truth here. I can read the Hebrew. Why don't I just do that? So it was 19 verses 1 through 10. And I'll give it brief. It's talking about, because I'll put the verses up probably soon. If people want to read themselves, they can do that.
And where they came up with Zacchaeus.
His name is Zakai in Hebrew.
Zakai.
It's difficult for me sometimes because the pastor is preaching and he's saying, the story of so and so. And I'm like, the story sounds familiar. I really don't recognize that name. Give me a verse with your name in it so I can remind myself what you're talking about. And suddenly I'm like, oh, that guy. Got it. Like, you know, it's just so funny to me that, like, are you kidding me? Sometimes it's sad. But James is the worst because it's supposed to be Jacob, which is usually Jacob in English. But King James wanted his name in the Bible, so the book of Jacob suddenly is the book of James.
Oh, okay.
But anyways, the brief of the story of Zakai is that he was a short man and he was a tax collector and he was a sinner. He sometimes ripped people off, and we don't know anything else he did, but he was a sinner. And he was curious about who Yeshua is. And Yeshua came through the town, and he was so short that he couldn't see him. He went up a tree to see him. Yeshua looks up and says, "Get down, I'm staying at your home tonight." And the next thing we know, Zacchaeus saying, "I'm going to give half my stuff to the poor, and everyone that I ripped off, I'm going to pay them back four times as much." And this is where we see a great example of repentance. He's saying, not only, okay, I'm not going to rip people off anymore, but I am going to enjoy what I did steal so far. He's saying, I'm going to give it back.
That's beautiful.
Yeah. And I'm going to give an entrance. Four times as much. And that's what I noticed that repentance is. And I know a lot of people are preaching, oh, but God loves us. And it is true that God loves us. And He loves us enough to die for us. And He loves us enough to meet us where we are when we're sinning. To come to us.
In the second half?
But He loves us too much.
To leave us where we were.
Alone where we were. And I can tell you from my testimony, and I know I'm repeating this, but it is really important, the sin that I was stuck in for so long. If I would have been under understanding or deception that God loved me anyways and it's okay and whatever, because I wasn't strong enough or wasn't willing enough to choose not to sin with the strength that God has given me and provided to me. Because it was extremely difficult, and that's why people still sin that are believers, because it's easier. Because they have free will and they make choices. But over there, I started feeling so convicted, I started saying, okay, Lord, what will be done? And I prayed and I begged God to truly transform my heart and my mind to match His will. And I was praying that for like a year until I finally got completely out of it. But I noticed that was literally transforming. I actually didn't want to sin anymore. Yeah. I actually didn't want to do what I was doing anymore. He was actually answering my prayer, even though it took a while. And it was a massive battle to get out of it. The enemy fought like he wouldn't believe to keep me in it. But if I would have stayed in it today, I would have been miserable still, even though I thought I was happy at the time. I would have been still a sinner, still cut off from God. I wouldn't have been married to my wonderful husband, which I'm so happy about. There's so many things that God has blessed me with that my only regret is that I started that sin in the first place.
Yeah.
But you know, God can use evil for good. So if this experience of mine can help teach others, then I will use it for that, for the glory of God. And this is something that God is expecting from us, to make that hard choice, to fight for Him. And to remember that He does love the sinners, He just hates the sin. And He wants them to be saved from it. And I even read in Titus and 2 Timothy chapter 3, I put it in the last month's Bible study at the end of it, verse 5 is referring to some religious leaders that are pretty much phony. And Titus, the whole book, it's really, really short book. I mean, it's a crazy short book, so please read the whole book. Titus is explaining to us very clearly how to treat people who are not obeying God's word in what way. First, it's describing what the elders should really be like and what leaders should really be like. And it even says, I think it's in Titus, I'll find it. There's a verse that says that those who refuse to be corrected and to turn to the right way don't have contact with them anymore. And that is probably because just like you can influence them, they can influence you.
Yeah.
Just like it says, don't marry an unbeliever because they might change you, thinking you can change them because they might change you. I'll find it, I'll look it up, and I'll put the addresses there. And when we read in the Hebrews this really terrifying, it's really terrifying, if you can find that other verse I mentioned, that would be great.
Titus?
I think someone comes. Night is a term. If we can find But when we find, sorry, in the Hebrews 10, I think it is, a very, very powerful, scary warning that those who continue to sin willingly, not those who stumble because they tried but they failed and turned back to God, those who willingly continue to sin because whatever they want to, or they're too, they don't care, not willing enough, I don't know what the reason is, after they have received the glory of God, the salvation, is like a person who trampled the blood of the Son of God underfoot. And that means their punishment will be far worse than people who never even heard of Yeshua in the first place. And that is a really terrifying warning.
Yes, yes.
Which one? Let's see. It's verse 13 in Titus 1. And it's true for this reason, you must be severe when you rebuke those who have followed this false teaching so that they will come to be sound in your trust. That's not the one I was talking about, but it's powerful too. The whole book of Titus is really powerful. And it's like 11 verses per chapter. And it's only like 3 chapters. So pretty much the whole book is like 1 chapter. So yeah, read it. I'll find the address and I'll put it up. Are there any questions for it, to anyone?
Not me.
No. Okay. None whatsoever. All right. So I'll let whoever watches this video comment below with their questions and comments and beliefs and anything else that you would like for me to talk about in the future and answer. And let's hope that I'll be able to answer everybody's questions in according to God's will and honor and glory and according to His revelation. I am going to pray about it and study it before I answer it, and I'm just going to tell you my opinion. Unless you ask me what Israel's like, because that's personally my opinion. ask whatever you like. So, let's close in prayer. Daddy, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for our wonderful company. Thank you for your word, and thank you for everything that you're teaching us. Lord, we pray that you will reveal to us your truth through your word. We pray, Lord, that you will just make it very clear to us what is your desire for us to remember and for us to practice and for us to do. Please teach us how to shine your true light and how to truly serve you and your children. Please teach us, Lord, to share your love with the world and the renewing of the mind. Please teach us, Lord, how to just make you so happy and follow you. How to resist this world and stand up for you. And Lord, I pray for anyone who's watching this video that you will just cover them with your protection. Burn through them, Lord, with your burning desire to know your truth, to know your word, to truly serve you and follow you wholeheartedly. Transform their hearts and minds to match your will, and ours too, Lord. Don't let your fire be quenched, but raise up people who will stand up for you no matter what, who will choose you over this world no matter what. Raise up your true people, Lord, that you will truly work through and shine your light through. Use us according to your will, and please don't let us get in your way. In Yeshua's most precious name. Amen. I just wanted to... It's funny how he reminds me of things while I pray. I wanted to mention real quick about not making any statues or images. Unfortunately, I remember having a very long discussion about it with people that didn't fully understand it. Any picture or statue that is supposedly of Jesus, first we know very clearly it's not really Jesus. The Catholic are based on Italian history, and that's pretty much like a few hundred years old kind of Italian history. we don't have any description whatsoever of what Yeshua looked like, and that's on purpose, because he did not want us to focus on what he looks like. We serve an invisible God. We serve an invisible God, and it is very, very important that we remember that we don't need to focus on his appearance. Even if he reveals himself to us, he does that without his glory. Because he commanded us very clearly not to make any picture or statue, whatever it looks like, even if it doesn't look like the Catholic Virgin. And at the end of chapter 20 here, in Names, in Exodus, it says very clearly not to make any gods of silver or gold with God. That means not to make all those supposedly items of worship or symbolic to God out of gold or silver. Now, I don't mean a symbol. If you wear an empty cross or a messianic symbol, that's a symbol. But if you have supposedly Jesus or an illustration of him on the cross, that's an image. And it is like you're making, and you're saying, this is my God, this is Jesus. That's where the problem is, when you recognize that illustration as your God. And he's actually saying clearly, not even to make with him. Verse 20, do not make with me God of silver and God of gold. You do not make to yourself. And he's saying only an altar of dirt or stone, uncut stone, so we will not pile it with our own sword, with our own tool to make for him. And that's something that we need to remember. That is what he wants from us. That is what he's expecting from us. And that is what we need to remember. That his word is his image. And we don't need to decorate our home with pictures. His word is what we need to follow.
I think the video's over, but he said in his word that we are to write his word on our doorpost, and the fence post, and we're to constantly have them in our mouths. We're to talk about them when we rise up, talk about them with our children, talk about them when we go to bed. That's in, I think it's in Deuteronomy.
That's how we're supposed to teach the next generation about God.
Good. You may remember it because that's the verse that says that you will bind it on your hand, and it will be as frontlets between your eyes. And that specific verse is what the religious Jews use when every Friday, and it's happened to me a couple of times, we'd be out at the mall and market, and there's this Jewish guy, he's this religious guy.
Thank you so much for watching. If you like, don't forget to click the like button below and share with everybody. Please subscribe for more recipes, Bible studies, and faith-inspired food arts. If you have any questions or requests, let me know in the comments below, and I promise to treat it as soon as I can. Have a wonderful, blessed day in Yeshua's name, and see you next time.